So welcome to the Talents Teddy Talk. It's a great pleasure and a great honor to celebrate this year the 13th anniversary of the Teddy Award within Berlinale. And yeah, please give them a warm applause here. The Teddy Award and also the initiative of Berlinale over so many years. It was a pioneer program for queer cinema, outstanding program since then, with so many directors, producers, and filmmakers coming around the world to Berlinale. But it was also the starting point for many other festivals to take care of queer cinema and the filmmaker scene worldwide. And I remember also Bruce LaBruce, we opened in the Guadalajara Film Festival in 2012, also Premier Margay. And it's a strong connection over the world. And please welcome also the guests here. And I would like briefly introduce Toby Aschaff. He's a film critic, a moderator, and also a festival manager himself. You are running also a film festival. And please enjoy the session today.
Thank you very much. Maybe some remarks before I introduce the wonderful panelists that you invited. So great, and Florian Vachon, also who runs the talent section, and that I'm very grateful for that he made a collaboration with the Teddies. This is supposed to be an experiment, and I didn't invent it, but others did. And so the confrontational situation is supposed to be a little bit broken up, and there's also a free seat here, and then there's a free seat here, and a free seat here, and I asked already a couple of people to sit down on the stage. They all said no, but maybe we can kind of like, you know, as we say in German, get warm with each other, and also like to kind of stress the interactive element. There's going to be some statements, of course, about maybe queerness or queer cinema, and since this is supposed to be a discussion, we have these wonderful green and red cards, so if there is something is said and you totally agree with this, you can raise your green one, and if you think that's complete bullshit, you can raise your red one. So we have, yeah, already you're warming up a little bit, there's some talk, that's good, so maybe we can practice this a little bit. Okay, Christine Vachon is an amazing producer. There are no red oh, wow, okay. Bruce LaBruce is a horrible filmmaker. What? Okay, good. You get the picture. You get the picture. I'm going to ask just a few questions, but I hope you have some too. Like most of you are, I think, talents in one way or another. Either you were selected for the talents or you were not selected and are as talented as the others. Let me introduce the wonderful guests here. First of all, the recipient of the honorary Teddy Award tomorrow night has also a film in the panorama section, Goat. Christine Vachon is not someone that you wouldn't know. She has been here ever since the beginning. The first film she ever produced was awarded with a Teddy Award. It's called Poison by Todd Haynes. Ever since she's produced, yeah, come on, give it up for her. Ever since then, she's produced all of the films of Todd Haynes, culminating, of course, quite famously in Carol, that opened in Cannes last year. Got about 150 nominations, about 50 awards so far, is nominated for 9 Academy Awards. She has 6 Academy... Why would you correct me on that? 6 Academy Awards. She has been producing almost 100 films and started together with Pamela Koffler, Killer Films in New York, and has also been producing Swoon, Boys Don't Cry, I can't name all of those films. Yeah, come on. Boys Don't Cry, A Dirty Shame, Kids. The films by Tom Kalin, Swoon, and so on and so forth. I have to stop at one point, otherwise this is kind of, we're going to fill the 2 hours by introducing her, but give her a big welcome, please. Yeah. Then I'm just going to have a random order. Let's take Klaus Händel, works under the artist name of Händel Klaus. He is here as a filmmaker with his film Tomcat Carter in the Panorama section, made another film called March that also won him a couple of prizes, but also he is an author of prose and radio plays, and also an actor. He's been acting in... He was an actor. Should I not talk about this? Okay, well... Google him and you'll find out that maybe he was in The Piano Player and Sophie Scholl, but I would not mention this on the stage. And yeah, give him a big welcome for Carter. We have here Adoma Owusu, who is a US-American visual artist and filmmaker. She has a beautiful film in the shorts competition called Reluctantly Queer. By the way, we're going to see clips of all these films a little bit later. Maybe we can have the one slide, the PowerPoint slide with all the posters on it, so we have a little visual. She has been here before in the shorts competition with a film called Kwaku Anansi that she won the African Movie Academy Award for. She has been at the Oberhausen, maybe you've been in Oberhausen last year. She made a wonderful little film called Busnut and has made her feature debut with Black Sunshine. What else can I say? She was called in 2013 by the Huffington Post one of the 30 contemporary art makers under 40 you should know as the Black Artist section. Has been working for or with no other than Kevin Jerome Everson, whose latest work is in the Forum Expanded section, was in the Forum Expanded section last year, and yeah, she's here with Reluctantly Queer. Please give her a big welcome. Sora Judenor is hopefully the right pronunciation now. I practiced a little bit. Is here with a wonderful film called Kiki. It's, I think, your first feature, right? It's your feature debut. Yes, she's been working for 18 years as a visual artist and also filmmaker. Her works have been commissioned in galleries, museums in New York, in Sweden, and all over the world. And she's been collaborating with Twiggy Pucci Garcon on this film. It's about the Kiki ballroom scene of New York. And there is actually an introduction that she wrote herself, and it's so good that I didn't want to like rephrase it. As a visual artist, documentary filmmaker, researcher, and educator, my work is informed by discussions around authorship and agency and resides in the crossing points of institutional critique, site-specific and public art, documentary cinema, and community-based participatory performative practice. My longitudinal projects often engage with communities facing different types of marginalization and investigates their strategies of existing in the world. You wrote this. It's on your homepage. Like, how can you rephrase that? I could have just like pretended I wrote it, but that would have been stealing. And now, Bruce LaBruce has been making films for since the beginning of the 90s or even the 80s, I think, has been awarded with a grand jury prize for his wonderful piece called Pierre Lunaire in 2013. Has been making more than 20 films, short films, long films, but also in Berlin, very famously, theater plays, is a writer, is a photographer. You can describe his work as underground, avant-garde, pornographic, transgressive, and we're going to watch films from his clip. We were going to watch clips from his film, Otto or Up With Dead People. Other names would be No Skin Off My Ass, Super 8.5, The Raspberry Reich, and so on and so forth. I think like also he needs just a short introduction because he's already quite famous here. Please welcome Bruce LaRue. Also in the audience, two queer filmmakers who were here last year and they don't want to be on the stage, Marcio Riolon and Felipe Matzenbacher, have their wonderful film Bera Mar in the Forum Generation Cross section. They're going to be here to present their web series afterwards that I'm also curious about. There are free seats here, maybe. Drink a glass of wine and join us, but maybe give them also a bigger round of applause. And join them later, and you all please join us in discussions. Like, I have one question. I had the question of, like, should I give an introduction to queerness and queer cinema? Then I thought, like, no, I'm not this teacher who tells the world how it's rolling. And so I thought, like, why not make it easy for myself and ask you what you think about it? And, like, when you were invited to this panel, maybe we start with you, Hendel Klaus. And you heard that this is supposed to be the finally new queer cinema. Like, what came into your mind? And, like, do you consider yourself to be a part of a new queer cinema?
Yeah, of course I am.
Okay, and why?
Yeah, because my film is about two men in love. And, of course, that's enough for me to say, well, this is a statement, of course, that living in this relationship is just the most natural thing to me. So I want to share this, of course. I mean, I thought we are different persons, of course, with different looks into the world or onto the world. And it's a very individual thing, of course, to share our personal look. But behind it, we have this force, I think, or to me it is a force of a naturality. So we don't have to, I want to put it very clear that it's nothing to be ashamed of, or I mean to even, I think I'm so lucky to have had so many people fight before that I am now in the privileged position of making a film that has two lovers of the same sex who live in a very natural way without even, how should I say? It's not even a thing to think about anymore in this case. I have learned yesterday that in Brazil there are Brazil is the country with the most gay murders on gays, and I didn't know that. And I am very aware that this leads too far. I'm sorry,
but no, just
for me, I am very aware of many things, and to now say a few phrases is so overwhelming. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I can do it, but of course I have an upbringing from a Catholic country, which is the Tirol in Austria, and I have very many friends who are in the closet, who are, it's their personal choice, and I'm not sure if it would be easy if they went out. So all I can do is encourage them, but it's for them to do it. I mean, I'm not, who am I to force them? but I live in this privileged situation, and learning, yes, and knowing that in all parts of the world, it is still a crime to be gay. Or I now say gay, but I always mean, of course, the whole, not heterosexual norm of living and behavior. But after all, it's a very individual thing, I think. In the end, it's individual, and we make individual films, and each relationship is individual, be it heterosexual, be it gay, be it trans, be it, I don't know. So this is a very confused first statement, I'm sorry.
Well, that's good. Queerness is all about confusing things. Thank you.
Sure. No.
I just want to have the first question to the audience. Like, okay, just imagine there's a film, and not particularly Carter, but just a film, and the description reads, it's about two gay men in love. Would you call that a queer film? Would you say, oh, that's part, this rings the bell of queer cinema? I see a lot of red, some green now coming up. Some people are having both in their hands. Okay. First confusion check. Bruce LaBruce, of course. Bruce LaBruce's films were called part of the queer cinema, new queer cinema that, of course, evolved, like, you know, in the early 90s, and where films like, you know, Christine Vachon's films like Poison or Swoon were called into The Living End also, but also, of course, Tongues Untied, Yeah, exactly. Goldfish, that Christine also produced, or Looking for Langsness, what I was searching for. Now, you said you don't actually want to be part of a queer cinema, but a queer core. Do you still say that, or can you maybe answer the same question? Like, do you feel like you're part of, or even a pioneer of, a queer cinema, or is that sort of like a label that you never wanted because you felt different in the difference?
Well, I'm sorry.
Can you use your mic? Sorry, can you use your mic?
I'm from sort of a different generation, so it's the whole gay liberation kind of, you know, era, which ushered in a certain kind of cinema and a certain kind of identity. So you have to put it, if you want to put it in a historical context or a political context, then, you know, it was much different then, because now we have this universal consciousness about how gays are being treated around the world because of globalization and various, you know, political and religious contexts, you know. But at that time, it was like a struggle everywhere, and it was a struggle in North America, and so there was a political consciousness built into the gay movement and the lesbian movement, and, you know, and the emerging transgendered movement, and that really inflected a lot of the films, and it was very personal cinema. It was so. A bunch of films, as you said, got identified as the new queer cinema in the late 80s, early 90s. And this was partly because there was a profusion of gay and lesbian film festivals in, especially in Europe and North America. So suddenly a small film like my film, No Skin Off My Ass, which came out in 1991, which was made for $14,000 at that time, went on the, it was shot on Super 8, it was blown up to 16, and it went on the film festival circuit and played internationally, you know. So if it hadn't been for that political thrust of the gay and lesbian film festival circuit, you know, exploding, my work probably would have never been seen on that kind of level. So and the ideas behind the new, I was just in Brazil last year and showed, there was a program of new queer cinema, American and British new queer cinema that was shown in Brazil, and it played in like seven cities. So it's become kind of like a little cult of a movement, you know, like a nouvelle vague, sort of, you know, the nouvelle vague of the queer world. And, you know, these films are considered now as kind of really breakthrough films that kind of broke through a lot of barriers, and they're appreciated for that, for their place in that historical moment, I would say. And then we could get into the definition of queer, which I'm sure we will. You know, for me, gay and queer mean two different, very vastly different things in a way. You know, queer is a much more political word for me, and it's more inclusive as well of race and different kinds of transgender identity, etc. I mean, I use it more as a catch-all for meaning that, meaning gay, lesbian, transsexual, intersex, you know, queer for me is a convenient way of including all those categories. And but in the 80s, I mean, just I'll add one more thing. In the 80s, you know, when Queer Nation came along, and I was in the punk movement, and we even didn't identify as queer necessarily in that same political way, because we felt ourselves as almost outsiders of the gay, certainly of the gay establishment. we, you know, my friends and I who did fanzines and films, there was a lot of problems in the gay movement, as there still is. You know, there's racism and sexism, misogyny, and this idea of separating lesbian culture and gay culture, and we really wanted to be against that, so we called ourselves more queer punks, and added an even more political dimension to it.
Can you tell me a little bit, because what I didn't mention is that, of course, it wasn't a movement, like it's never a movement from themselves, like the new queer cinema movement was, of course, like was either Ruby Rich and others have labeled that in a way, and it was not the filmmakers themselves. I think Christine, maybe correct me if I'm wrong on this, who like said, we are a group right now, like as it always is with movements. When did you call yourself queer? When did you start that? Because that seems like a different story, because you, out of emancipatory or, you know, maybe sort of like, yeah, transgressive movement called yourself queer, used that term differently.
Well, I'm not even mentioned in Ruby Rich's book, I have to say. So, you know, we had a, you know, my films were different in as much as all my films have been sexually explicit as well. And if not, and sometimes downright pornographic, like working very much inside pornographic conventions. So they were already always by definition more underground, more, you know, not as widely distributed perhaps, but they did get a lot of play in international film festivals regardless of this, you know, really strong pornographic content. But yeah, we were just sort of, my friends and I in Toronto at that time in the mid 80s, we felt like we were alienated from the gay mainstream. And we were more attracted to punk because of its political, you know, energy and its aesthetics and everything. But then we found out in punk there was also homophobia and misogyny at that time. So we felt like we were sort of caught between these two subcultures, and we took what we thought was the best of both and kind of made our own thing out of it.
Thank you very much for that. And Sora, you made it, yeah. Sora, you made a film that I already called yesterday an update of Jenny Livingston's Paris is Burning, also a film that, talking about queerness, was criticized both by Bell Hooks and Judith Butler for various reasons. And but you go back into the ballroom scene and make a very emancipatory film about the people and the outcasts and the marginalized queers in a very different New York now. And maybe you can tell me a little bit about your approach also to queer cinema, and if Paris is Burning is even a reference point for your film that you made together with Twiggy Pucci-Gasson.
Yeah, sure. So I feel, I mean, the new queer cinema of the 90s, because I'm, you know, I'm kind of older, so I'm not, even though this is the first documentary feature in the film world, I very much identified and were inspired by the new queer cinema films. They were very important when I was younger, but yes, so this particular film, of course, Kiki, has this, of course, has this connection to Paris is Burning. And but I think it's important also to see that before Paris is Burning, it was The Queen, which I think is a very interesting film that also should be talked about, and also Marlon Riggs and Tongues Untied, and there's other films. And I think Paris is Burning is an exceptional film, but when we did, started the project, I was invited to do the project by leaders in this new movement within the ballroom scene in New York called the Kiki scene, that's very political, very activist. And Twiggy Pucci-Gasson, we met, and they set up a meeting with me and invited me to make a film with them. And I had the feeling then that they were almost held hostage by Paris is Burning. They were like, of course, I mean, that's the film, they're 25, you know, now, or a little older. I mean, this was an important film for the kids in the Kiki scene too. They've seen it, it's a reference point, but they felt that, you know, why this was a painful time for the community in the 80s. It's a painful film in many ways. So why only that film? And I was like, oh, you know, of course. I was worried because it's a new queer cinema classic. So I was like, okay, so how could, you know, they deserve a film with its own strong artistic identity. So in a way, it was a challenge. Maybe that we tried even harder because of it. So I think it worked in our favor. But I noticed, too, when we were trying to finance the film, that people would say, like, oh, you know, Paris is burning. It made us see the world in a different way. They said, you know, there could be like a stop there. And I wonder, who's we? You know, what's the perspective there? And why not? This is such an important subculture that existed in Harlem and now internationally for over 100 years. It's an important part of the cultural fabric of New York City. You know, they deserve a lot of films. And also, I should say, what, you know, our approach, and this is a, you know, it's co-written with Twiggy. This was extremely important. Felt impossible to do the film without it being a very close collaboration. But it's really a character-driven coming-of-age film. So I feel like that's incredibly important. It's about these seven people, and they made these extraordinary journeys from, you know, being homeless to going to represent at the White House, or, you know. There's several important stories.
You're talking so much about it. Maybe we can just, like, you know, we come to you in a second and watch the clip number one. A little clip from Kiki. Did you want to add something to what you said before? Otherwise, we have this.
Yeah, this is Devo. Extraordinary person, amazing dancer. It's one of the people in the film. You know, the film's characters, many of them are very articulate. You know, likes to talk, has the power of speech. But Devo speaks through his dance. He's an excellent speaker as well, but he told me that he doesn't like to speak. He likes to express himself through the dance. Yeah.
I want to come back to the film later, but, like, maybe go on with Christine Vachon, the queen of new queer cinema. Said long time ago she doesn't want to be called the queen, corrected me yesterday, said, I want to be the queen of anything if you name it to me. So welcome the queen, producer of Poison, of Goldfish, and Swoon. And by that, we've already named three of the sort of like landmark films. And we also like talked a little bit about the urgency to make these films back then. And maybe you can... also ask the question of what is produced right now, because the AIDS crisis is not a crisis in that sense in US America or Europe anymore. Like, a lot of my friends get infected, but it's like having diabetes and people are not dying. If, you know...
In America,
that's what I said. Okay, you want to correct me right now? Come on, jump in.
No, I would say that it's very much a crisis still.
Mm-hmm. Agreed.
That's what I disagree. Want. Like, disagree. Come on.
But I do think it's important, and I don't want to, you know, you guys heard me, a lot of you heard me talk yesterday, so I don't want to repeat myself. But, you know, these movies that, certainly the ones I was involved in the early 90s, they were all galvanized around the AIDS crisis. That was what, there was a sense of urgency. There was a sense that if people didn't get to tell their stories, they would never get to tell them. And also, you know, there was a lot of, and this goes back to some of the things Bruce said, there was a sense of a lot of division in the gay community, the gay and lesbian community, the queer community, of just, you know, some feeling that, you know, some of the movies that were coming out, you know, that I made, filmmakers like Bruce made, Greg Araki, were considered films that were showing the, you know, the gay community in too negative a light. They were a little too fucked up. And they were angry. You know, a lot of these movies were really angry. So this sense of providing, there was a sense that there had to be sort of one positive image that everybody lined up behind and said, okay, this is, you know, this is who we are. But for a lot of people, you know, who weren't white, weren't male, you know, who didn't feel like they were, you know, that the mainstream culture was what they were aspiring to, you know, they felt very left out. And that, I think, is, you know, defined a lot of those movies. I mean, one thing I think is interesting that, you know, kind of came up at the first question you asked is, you know, is if a movie is about, you know, two men falling in love or two women falling in love, is it a queer film? And I'd take that further and say, you know, well, what makes a movie a queer film? And now, you know, the kinds of production that we're involved in, which has become more and more inclusive, you know, and more diverse, I aspire to both of those things being more so. But when you take a film like Still Alice, where, you know, it's a mainstream film directed by, you know, two gay partners, you know, and how do you start to parse out, like, does it have to be the story? Does it have to be the sensibility? Does it have to, what, you know, where do you draw the line, you know? And I sometimes get, I sometimes feel a little, you know, I feel that it's a little reductive to take, for example, the body of work that I've produced and say, okay, these ones are queer because that's what they're about, and these ones aren't because that's not what they're about. You know, when you're talking about filmmakers, you know, like Todd Haynes, like Wash Westmoreland, like Rose Trochet, you know, where does it begin and end?
And talking about these films, I would say with an idea of agency, with an idea of politics, for example, maybe another question to the audience. Would you say that if we talk about queer cinema or queer films, this automatically has to be, politics have to be involved? A queer film is a political film. What do you think?
Politics coming in all shapes and forms.
Good question.
I mean, aren't all films political in some
Isn't
way, shape,
good?
Or form?
Yeah.
Say, yeah. It depends on the audience the film is being. And it depends on the audience
the Okay, what do you mean by the. It depends on the reading of the film, you mean? Mm-hmm. The context, you say?
Like something like Carol, or like that revolves around this kind of. Oh, sorry. The politic is ingrained in the nuance and the subtlety and the poetics. And like, if the politic is in the poetics, that doesn't make it any less political, but that changes the scope of the politic and how we understand the politic.
Could you, by that, read every film politically in that way?
If there's a poetic that I can understand through a politic, I mean, yes and no. Like, I think if the film can present an image that serves to like create some type of rupture in the images you've seen before, then there is an inherent politic in that. If a rupture has been made or a kind of reflection can be held up that shows you something, a new way to think about something differently, like regardless of whether there's some kind of like this is political with a capital P or a lowercase p, whatever. But I think the idea of being able to like be shown something, I don't mean new as in like innovative, I mean new as in like a juxtaposition, right? Like you put, when something follows something else, what came before it creates a different dynamic.
Would you agree on that? Because the idea of the original and the fresh is exactly like how you started to produce films like Poison. And maybe we can talk also a bit about the aesthetics, because thank you for your comment, by the way. You already mentioned it. Is queer cinema an aesthetic question also? Is it not a form question? You know, do we always need to talk about content, or what Todd Haynes did in Poison, of course, has so much to do with the form, with the aesthetic, and with like queering sort of like genre also. Would you say that is always connected to some kind of queerness in film?
This is getting very intellectual for me. I guess I would just go back to say that I think narrative is inherently political, and it's just, you know, the story that you're choosing to tell, who's in it, who's not in it, all of those things, I mean, you kind of can't get away from it.
Maybe we come to you
sure.
Now, finally.
I think we should just show the clip.
I would suggest the same thing. It's clip number, it's Reluctantly Queer. Clip number 7, please. It's a 30-second clip from a 9-minute film. Do you want to say something about it before, or do you... Okay. I was looking into your films, and I was also thinking about queerness in your work. Like, I think that sexuality in, like, as it is here in this film, in the title, and with Kwame, who is your protagonist, who writes in this film a letter through this film to his mother in Ghana, is something that is not, I wouldn't say the thread of your work, actually. Questions of identity, you know, the living in Ghana, living in Accra, living in the United States, and trying to and making films in Ghana actually is a big thing. So your films are about identity politics, mm-hmm. which can be connected to queerness. This is the only thing that is connected to sort of like a sexual idea of queerness. So maybe you want to tell me what you thought when you were invited to this panel.
Yeah, I mean, I just think the term queer in general is slightly problematic because it's a term that it's a term that kind of is who does it include, who does it exclude, right? And for me, thematically, my films have always been about telling stories. And Kwame is who's the protagonist and my friend. I felt that it was very important for me to share his perspective as being identifying as a queer Black male from Ghana living in the States. And you know, queerness is like, somehow it gives us this sense of home, right? The sense of place, or it's related to identity, right? And you know, we as human beings, we tend to, we crave identity, right? We crave this idea of home. This letter that he's writing to his mother from the States kind of helps him release him of this anxiety of not being Black in America while not being able to express himself as being having same-sex desire in Ghana, where it's not as free to, you're not as free to express yourself as you would in America. And I just felt that it was important to put a face this coming from the context of contemporary Ghana. It's not something that you quite see in cinema. And even though his struggles is very internal, I felt that it paralleled my experiences as being Ghanaian American and dealing with my identity issues as a Ghanaian American. And so it is a parallel to a lot of the films that I explore.
And also talking about the form, you know, you're using, sorry, did I interrupt you? You're using 60 millimeter and you have sort of like a double projection. And I was wondering, I haven't seen this in other of your films that I've seen. And I was wondering if sort of like, you know, the queerness of the film was kind of like asking you to also play with the form, if the form and the content are connected in that way.
Yeah, well, you know, I'm always kind of, my films are a rendering of, you know, Du Bois's notion of double consciousness and this idea that, you know, this why it's the idea of queerness or being reluctantly queer, whether you're like that uncertainty of being in and out. And I kind of call it my triple consciousness in the sense that it is inclusive. It's an all-inclusive cinema. So when you have that kind of dual screen or sort of going back and forth, there is that space of the in-between to kind of play with these sorts of ideas. You know, one can argue that, you know, I identify as a heterosexual female. Why create a film about a queer man, you know? So, I mean, that could be read as, you know, a political statement. I'm just really concerned. I find that I have a cultural privilege of being able to use cinema and film to tell a story that a lot of Ghanaians are now beginning to pay attention to, really, that they wouldn't have had we been in Ghana at this time. So, I just felt that it was important, being a filmmaker, that I have this privilege to put a face to Kwame's story that a lot of people can relate to in Ghana.
Did you also connect to some sort of activism in Ghana together with Kwame? I thought it was shot in the U.S. By the way,
Shot in the U.S.
It is,
yes.
It, okay. Mm-hmm. Did you like want to show it there?
Absolutely.
Kind of,
yeah. Eventually, we would love to show it there.
And also, like about showing you about showing films in Ghana. There's a cinema that you have been starting to kickstart. It's maybe goes a little bit away from the queer thing, but also maybe about, like, you know, how can films be seen? And there's the Rex Cinema in Accra that you sort of want to Revive. Revive. And yes, maybe tell us a little bit about that sort of like cinema activism that you're doing there.
Well, I'm just really concerned about reviving this Ghanaian cinema. It's straight to video, so a lot of the films don't really have theatrical releases. And one of my goals is really to bring that back, return to this early ways of viewing films in contemporary Ghana. Yeah.
Are there first interruptions or questions or interventions from the audience? Kind of like through with the first round. There's one here. Yeah.
My name is Vivian Kleiman. I was Marlon Riggs' film partner. And I really appreciate your using of the word inclusion, because I really, I am more inclined to expand the notion of quote-unquote queer cinema rather than to try to narrow it down. I think the emphasis should be on giving voice, tongues untied, to all of the as many aspects of queer life and in life in general in the world.
And Tongues Untied really inspired me. Tongues Untied and also Waiting for Langston. So, yeah.
So I would rather see us working towards the expansion and inclusion rather than narrowing and narrowing the definition.
Thank you very
can
much.
Can I comment? Can I make a comment? Sorry. I just want to say something. Sorry to grab the mic. I just keep staring at this empty chair, and I actually really appreciate that you, you know, talked about how you identify, because I realize that, you know, I don't want to presume, but there's no person of trans experience on this panel, and, you know, we talk about inclusion, and I feel like it's extremely important that people of trans experience and their stories are more visible. And I would, you know, speak for Gia that's on the poster there, a woman of trans experience. She does not identify as queer. So, you know, if she would be here, she would have a long, brilliant speech about that.
It's a very, I find it to be a very limiting term. It's like, what is queer? You know, I mean, it's just, it gives us a sense of, it's something that we could say, okay, this is identity. This is what you can identify with. And I think we need to move beyond these terms, whether it's being black or white or queer or, you know, like, we need to kind of move beyond these specific terms. I have, I don't know if you want to piggyback on
that. Oh, you asked me?
Yeah.
I think that there's a personal. You know, I agree with Bruce. For me, I'm queer. So for me, it's like that's the kind of, you know, for me, it's a political queer person. For me, it is tied up with, you know, being political. But I guess it's just when what I was excited about new queer cinema was the cinema part and that the experimentation. This was brought up yesterday in the discussion with Christine. I was like, you know, thinking also Bruce films, like, how did you get them out? Like, I just feel like it's amazing that, you know, it was very interesting cinema, and it was not picked up just because there were, you know, it was about cinema, about storytelling, not just about the kind of subject matter. It's about form very much. And
but it was also about an audience that was very hungry to see those stories.
So it's kind of like an activation of the cinema is like an activation of this, of queer.
I think one thing we have to put into the mix is the changing nature of what it means politically to be gay. So, the assimilationist movement and how mainstream it is now. So queer, I think, has this leftover sort of meaning of or subtext of political leftism. I mean, it's a very leftist kind of
and intervention. I would say
and
political
and activist. And activist, yeah. Whereas gay, I think, has become. I mean, now it's not being gay is not a reliable indicator of whether someone's left or right or you know situated particularly on the political spectrum. Whereas you know in the 80s. Even the mainstream gays were largely leftist in their. I mean, not wholly, but
because they couldn't really be mainstream.
Well, that's true. But it's also just a matter of power and kind of like a certain kind of power, a certain kind of gay sort of patriarchy emerged, as they call it now, where you know, people who had the money and the power became more conservative and on a certain level, even in terms of how they approach political activism. And it's been argued, of course, that the AIDS crisis did kind of like channel a lot of the energy of the movement and the money in this kind of gay white male kind of movement. So, you know, that's very political in that way, to use the word queer, to distinguish it as this kind of leftist oppositional movement that emerged at that time, as opposed to what we have now, which is much more connected to mainstream politics in terms of the thrust of the gay movement in general. You know.
And I feel like there tends to be, like, you were talking about white gay males, and that seems to be like the standard. And, you know, like, when we're talking about being queer or gay, but we never quite talk about other forms, other types of queerness from other parts of the world, whether it's on the continent of Africa or Asia. And I really wanted to show that there isn't quite a standard of being queer. You know, Kwame and I have a very strong relationship, to the point, like, even sometimes when we're walking around in Ghana, you know, people, I mean, don't really quite know whether he's my lover or whether we're, you know. And I think that's his identity is quite fascinating. It's a different kind of queerness. He never really expressed himself sexually in Ghana until he came to America, you know, and had an understanding of his same-sex desire, because it wasn't something that was really talked about in Ghana.
Well, in America and Europe too, I think it's a generational thing, because the gay movement has been around, LGBT movement has been around for a lot longer, and so it's there's maybe a new generation now who have benefited from the activism that went before, but they also don't feel the need so much to identify as queer. They don't want to pigeonhole themselves as something. You know, they want to be a little more fluid in their gender identity. So that's something else that we have to take into consideration.
I want to point out two things that I find interesting. First of all, that you say that you sort of criticize that queer is like an identity term. From what I learned, I mean, it's called queer theory, and like, I come from a different sort of angle on this. I learned that you can never actually be queer. You can just queer something, you know, and that queer is the opposite of identity politics. And it means that there is never something that it includes a lot of things like race, ethnicity, gender, and stuff like that, but it can never be. And then also what you said, Bruce, like the catch-all thing is something in the German discourse, at least what happened here. You know, all of a sudden it's like, oh, we need something new, gay and lesbian is kind of like, it doesn't seem progressive enough for us. Now it's a queer award. Now it's a queer magazine. Everything is queer without really an understanding. And that's why I'm kind of a little bit stressing the 90s history and also the AIDS crisis of the 80s a little bit, that these things kind of a little bit wishy-washy right now and seem to be like this kind of like pleasing umbrella for everything, because the LGBTI and all the letters we have to add there is kind of like too complicated, and it's kind of like chic to use the word queer. Do you want to say something about this?
Queer, I think you have to, when it first came out, was a sort of reclaiming the word faggot, you know, or dyke. It was reclaiming a derogatory term, you know, and that was certainly its, you know, its genesis. What it's being used for now, you know, there might be some truth to what you're saying, but I think it's important to remember that.
I don't know. I just wanted to say something about the mainstream, because when I started working with the Kiki scene, you know, I came from this, you know, I'm from northern Sweden, so, you know, I was very much an outsider to the scene, and I was like, oh, it's an underground, you know. Oh, wow, it's like I found old New York again, and I was being so excited about it. And they're like, this sucks. Like, underground, like, we want to be overground. Like, underground means that we don't get any credit, you know. Like, you know, being, you know, on the margins means not having power, and they will not have it. So there's an enormous force and anger in this community. We say, like, you know, we're part of the world. Like, we don't want to be some exotic underground, you know, the entertainment. Like, we want to have rights, basic civil rights. And it's an enormous crisis. You know, people are dying. Like, this group is just the demographic that the Kiki scene belongs to. It's like the HIV infection rate is up to 50%. You know, people are dying from all kinds of things. Twiggy, Pucci Garcon, my collaborator, lost like 40 people during the time that we made the film. So, and this is just in the United States, where you think that a lot has happened. And look in all other countries, and I want to bring out what you said again. Like, this is also part of being political, is to see, you know, oppression is still there. It just takes different forms. And no way that I, you know, me or anyone I know want to be not part of the mainstream, meaning, you know, not part of the world.
Cheryl, didn't you?
I think you have to make a distinction between underground and marginal or marginalized. I mean, traditionally, the underground served a purpose which was oppositional to the mainstream for a reason, you know. It was a space where you didn't have certain rules that you had to conform to, that you could express even formally. You know, a filmmaker could express themselves in a way that can't be mainstream, like Warhol's, you know, Empire or something of that nature is a kind of underground film for a reason, because an audience isn't going to sit for 24 hours and watch a film of the Empire State Building. And he became mainstream, his work became mainstream, but there's many examples of underground filmmakers who choose to be underground because it is oppositional, and it's because you are not expected to conform either aesthetically or politically to a certain agenda to get your, you know, to make your art, you know. So I know what you mean about visibility and how important it is, and in order to try to change you know, laws and civil rights and everything, obviously there has to be that kind of movement, but I wouldn't dismiss the underground completely.
There's an audience question over here.
I think it's more a comment. I think when we talk about, I mean, I made now just a short film from Israel, and I think for me it's very important to say that it's a political queer film, and I think it's very important as queer filmmakers, however we define ourselves, that, I mean, for me it's very important to say that queer is political, and what it means is that we are connected to politics. You know, for example, Israel likes using queers and gays to promote itself as like a, you know, like a good state or whatever, you know, and it's very important for me that, you know, this is my community, this is the people I come from, this is where I want to have these discussions, you know, also in Israel, but also as kind of more like international, for example, community. But we always, I think, do need to remember the local politics of where we come from, and not to go also just into this kind of film world where we are creating images that are just kind of separate from reality, but also not the images themselves, also kind of the discussion around it and where we place ourselves and how we get the message out and to who and what, you know, the discussion around it is also, I think, very important for me.
The next question is here, and then Itzik.
Yeah, I just want to also bring part of the discussion around self-censorship and bullying as well. I think for me what's important is a diversity of voices and opinions. And sometimes what I have issues with the notion of a queer agenda sort of limiting the amount of discussion that becomes visible, that can take place. So it can be something that opens up, but it can also be something that that restricts the voices and the possibilities for discussion, which I find problematic.
I have a question for you guys about referring what you said in your project that you promote the building a cinema to show films that it will be accessible. And compared to the 90s, many LGBT films were distributed. They were released in big cinemas. I grew up on them, and I think that during the years, less and less films are distributed. They go straight to all to DVD or to Netflix or to those channels, and people actually watch films at home. They watch it on the computer, in mobile phones, in public transportation. Even, you know, I see people that watch movies during the ride. So, is it important for you where those films are shown? How can you? What do you think? How can we or you or everyone can promote going to a cinema, distributing those films, making it accessible to more people?
Do you mind if I got a lot to say about that, but I won't. I'll keep it short. The first thing is, I don't think you can put that genie back in the bottle. The second thing is, though, actually, these movies, or what I would say content, you know, LGBT content, queer content, whatever you want to call it, is more accessible than it's ever been. And I see that ultimately as a positive thing. I mean, when we made movies in the 90s, the reason why you saw them in the cinema was because all these other platforms we're talking about didn't exist. But it also meant, I mean, part of how we built our audience was we made any movie that had any gay or lesbian content whatsoever, the community was so starved to see themselves on screen that they'd go see anything. You know, if you just said, you know, here's this movie, it's not that good, but it's got some, you know, women kissing women and men kissing men. People, okay, you know, they would go. They really would. And it sort of allowed us to build this notion, you know, especially in the States, where, you know, for us to keep making movies, audiences have to want to see our movies. There's no subsidies. So we were able to figure out, like, if you made a movie for the right amount of money, if just the gay and lesbian audience went to see it, you could make your money back. But now, I think there's so many different kinds of content that you can be very specific. You can say, you know, I'm only interested in this kind. You know, I'm not interested in something that's more mainstream. I only want experimental, or vice versa. So I guess at the end of the day, I welcome a world where, you know, there is a little, different kinds of communities can be created around different kinds of content. I don't think watching movies on the big screen is going to go away, because I think it's a very, you know, it's the kind of experience you can't have anywhere else, like hearing live music. But I do think that the way we consume content is going to have absolutely an effect on the kind of stories we tell, for better or worse.
Hi. Oh. Sorry, thanks. Actually, my question for you, Christine. I was wondering regarding the film industry. Now we are talking about the queer and all the facets of the queer cinema. But when I think about the film industry, what is going to the cinemas and what the public is watching, and whatever they are, queer or not queer, heterosexual, whatever, do you think there is a division or some more mainstream perspective of it? Because on my point of view, I come from distribution and sales agent, there is much more a space for gay cinema, male gay cinema, than, for example, lesbian, if you're talking only about gay and lesbian, and much less if you're talking about trans and intersexual films. And I was wondering regarding the film Carol, for example, that there was some articles, at least, that I read, I don't know, better for you to say about, regarding the super small released in America in the first weeks, and they were actually talking about it was strategy for the Oscars and everything. So do you think it was really like this, or no, is it really a prejudice against lesbian films, as they say, like this, or a preference for gay male, or no, it's totally other thing?
I mean, at the end of the day, I think you could just take your question and expand it into, is there more of a preference for male-driven films over female-driven films, taking sexuality out of it? And the answer is yes, there is. And it's drag, and I make a lot of female-driven films, usually quite successfully. Somehow, you know, those movies, there is a bias against, female-driven narrative. And that's, you know, we're working very hard to turn that over.
My question isn't totally related, so if anybody has something that fits better, I'm totally willing to go after that. It's more a general question.
Just go.
Okay. I'm not sure if I can phrase it well. I'm really interested in the queer perspective in with regards to spirituality. I know that's something that is more at odds with each other. A lot of people come from a place where they felt very much rejected by the institution, church, and all of that. And I'm a white, heterosexual woman who spent her 20s being super conservative evangelical, so I know that those terms are almost like mutually exclusive, the queer, homosexual, and the church and spirituality. So I'm kind of interested in, if we're talking about a new queer cinema, if there's any kind of development or also an inclusion on that part, if there are changes, if spirituality or religion is a topic that's becoming more interested or interesting to the filmmakers and that scene as well. I don't know, because I feel like that's not a topic that's talked about a lot, and I'm very interested. I might be the only one, though.
There's also a chance for Handel Klaus to come on board again. He's been awfully quiet.
Yeah, because my English is so... for me, I think that I was so happy to hear that you don't like to draw, to pull those drawers, or that I'm not the. I mean, yes, what you two said in the last parts, I found very right to each one. I mean, to have an underground and be proud of it, but also have the power to surpass that and to have our rights or their rights or all our rights, really. And again, I go back to the individuality or to the own mentality or identity. Because my identity is very much nourished by Tyrolean upbringing, which makes me, very different from a guy from Berlin, for instance. I feel like, for me it was important to show two males living their everyday life in a very, how should I say, even challenging way, because it's so beautiful and love is there and it's easy until something happens and love becomes difficult. And so really it's about love, and to me love is shows when it becomes difficult. I mean, the way I understand love.
Also, one thing that we haven't really talked about is like the new talk of the new queer cinema, like with filmmakers like Travis Matthews and also Iris Access, Keep the Lights On, all center very much with a new sensibility around actually couple questions that are white, male, gay couples. And if we look at Felipe and Matthews' film, Vera Mar, it is also just about a gay couple, but they are from Brazil, and you said this actually, and it's an activist sort of queerly political film. There are many questions. I actually wanted to show a clip of the film, but maybe direct questions here and then there.
Wait, I don't think we answered her question. For me, you have to separate, of course, spirituality from organized religion, of course. I think a lot of these films can be called spiritual in their own way that we're talking about, not in terms of an organized religion. And as you said, the organized religion has been the enemy for a lot of queer people over a long period of time. So it's not something that I think, people can jump into it as a critique often of religion, but you have to separate that from what everyone's individual idea of spirituality is. And I think a lot of films have their own sense of spirituality. So.
Out and sorry, I was just saying there's a whole crap ton of movies that have been made.
No, I just wondered if there was anything that surpassed just the dichotomy of like, we can't go there and they can go here.
You know, I did a photo exhibit in Madrid in 2012, I think, called Obscenity, and I used a lot of Catholic imagery with a lot of very frank sexual imagery, sometimes homosexual imagery. And it caused a huge furor, and there was protests and everything. But I mean, I personally didn't intend it to be necessarily blasphemous. I meant it to be a comment on the way that that religious ecstasy and sexual ecstasy are often overlap, and in terms of iconography and in terms of the history of saints and et cetera. So it was a serious investigation for me into that topic, but with a really strong queer angle. And the queer part was what enraged, you know, the Catholic, Orthodox people the most. So I think, you know, it's always a delicate subject, and sometimes if you interject it with a queer sensibility, then it's going to cause problems because the church hasn't up to now been open to homosexuality. So.
It's a subject matter in our film as well. Twiggy is very a spiritual leader. He got kicked out of church because he was too feminine, but then this kind of spiritual leadership he brought to the Kiki scene, so they call him the MLK of the Kiki scene.
That's a good example.
I just wanted to comment, and maybe one of you would like to comment specifically in regards to Carol, because I think what at one point Kate Blanchett said was very interesting. She said, I think, that 10 years ago this film would be much more be considered as a lesbian story, as a probably queer story, but now it is a lot about all the other elements in it. So it's, of course, and you already mentioned that, it's about the context and the shifting context, not just locally, but also the generation and the era. And it's where do you draw the line? And I think the element is still there, but probably it got just less important in the context of the whole film. And a friend of mine just started a queer film festival, actually at the place where Handel Klaus is coming from, in the Catholic context, and she struggles a little bit where to draw the line and what to include in this specific festival and what not to include, and how provocative it still is or no longer is. So this is also about the context of time.
Well, as it relates to Carol, I think great love stories, for a great love story to work, there has to be something that keeps the lovers apart, right? And these days, it's harder and harder in modern society to find the traditional things that keep people apart, which is why there's a lot of period love stories. And, you know, and in Carol's case, I don't think there's any mistake that it's a lesbian love. I mean, I think people think of it as a lesbian love story because that is what it is. That said, what I find kind of exciting, and it actually comes back to some things that you were saying, is Carol and Therese, especially Therese, they don't even have the language to articulate. She doesn't have the language to articulate what's actually happening to her. You know, she doesn't. I mean, that to me is one of the exhilarating things about the film, is as she, you know, discovers her love and the film almost clinically, but with a great deal of emotion, dissects what it's like to fall in love for the first time. Her inability to actually attach any language to it kind of makes it, you know, exhilarating and universal in this way. So, but it is what it is.
The next question, did you want to say? Is it related to Hänsel Klaus, or do you?
It is, actually, okay. Because it started off with sort of the original question that you asked, which is this a queer film that you were talking
Shall
about?
Shall we watch a one-minute clip before your question, or would you, yeah? Okay, that would be nice, I think. Mm-hmm.
It also, what inspired me to raise my hand was we were talking about Ira Sachs, and that was brought up. And when we were talking about your film, this thought came to mind. It's from the film Love is Strange. Yeah. Shows, like, you know, an older couple.
Very important for me. It was a real reference film. Exactly. for my DOP as well. We were watching many films, also in order to find out how to show, how lovers live also naked. I mean, because this is in paradise, they are naked, and this was, of course, Ira Sachs.
No, but what I wanted to say is that 20 years ago, you know, in the gay rights movement, LGBTQI was not used then, you know? And it was gay, lesbian, and queer. And I remember Queer Nation forming and whatnot, and there was a whole sense of being transgressive. And if you look back then and look at a film that deals with being domestic, having cats, and like everyday existence, it doesn't seem like that there's a connection. However, I was at a talk for that film where this was maybe 3 years ago. this is when in Russia they were sending out all these YouTube videos of victims that were being caught. They were beating them up and like threatening them and, you know, peeing on them, doing all these awful, disgraceful things. And in the talk, there was a man that was from the UN and saying, like, what does this film, Love is Strange, have to do to offer protection politically for gays around the world? And the discussion came to a place where I mentioned and other people mentioned that sometimes it's not that the film's topic matter has to do with being on the front line of what's happening. Right. Yeah. Sometimes it's, you know, the implication that this love can exist, mm-hmm. and showing it to an audience, for example, in Russia.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Where that does suddenly become a very political thing.
Yeah.
But the intention of it may not be outright political. So it's not always directly theme related. Sometimes it's the reception of it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Please repeat it.
It depends very much on the audience if a film where man kissing is political or not. Even here in Berlin, it can be, to a certain audience, be a radical movie.
And I recall when I was a boy and I was watching films, whenever there was something, gay about it or in it or hidden, or maybe be it unconsciously, I don't know, by an actor or by just Lofton or something, you know, it would just ring a bell, and I was very aware of it. So, I mean, even without thematizing it, and it was important for me, many of those films or parts. But, I mean, it's just that art speaks, it always speaks, and but I'm talking the most general thing here, so I'm sorry.
I mean, I guess you also have to take into consideration, though, on a larger political level, like what films, as Christine was talking about, what films get financed, and it's a lot harder to get like a female love story than a white male couple is the easiest thing to finance. That doesn't mean that it's not valid and doesn't have an audience and a right to exist. But if you look at the broader picture about how films are made and what kind of films are made and why they're made, there's still an imbalance in that sense.
I mean, I think that being portraits of happiness extremely important political. It doesn't have to do with that. It's also always, wealthy people being happy. For example, I keep wondering why do people have to die, or why do you? I was thinking about the Danish girl. Like, I haven't seen it, but I read that the two people in the film, the main character in the film, the woman, that she actually did not die, that soon, that it was portrayed in the film, and that they lived in this lesbian relationship. I just wonder, why wasn't that part of this Hollywood film? Or, I feel like...
Yeah, Danish Girl just isn't really a Hollywood... You can't really call it a Hollywood film. Just, it wasn't... If you're talking about how films are financed, it was distributed in America by a mainstream company, but it was made with, in Britain with British money.
All right.
I think it makes a difference. I really don't...
But my point is about whether, I feel I'm longing for not normative happy endings, but, more nuanced happiness. And I know that the people in our film, that's one of the things that they strive for. They're like, we want to be happy, and we want to be portrayed. They are unhappy with Paris is burning, and, it's so tragic, Venus dies, and... they feel like, we get depressed when we saw this. Like, we want to feel that we can have a long life. For trans women, we don't want to die at 35. Can we see... I feel like, isn't it important to see these stories, too? So, I don't know.
Yeah, I think what you're just talking about is underserved audiences who aren't getting to see themselves represented and aren't getting to see... Ideally, there'd be a variety of different stories. Because some of us like those unhappy, fucked up endings. But that's the idea, that there should be, with inclusion, with diversity, comes different kinds of stories.
There is a question over here.
Hi, thanks for the film. My question is kind of related to what you just said. My question is, do you consider there is a necessity of keeping a good image of queer characters in the films, especially in countries where queer is not widely accepted? Because I come from China, and last year in China, there was a queer film got public distributed in cinema, and it also revealed some government the bad side of the government, so that's a huge progression in China. But in the end, the two main characters got into prison. So I can still see that the government tries to keep it as a bad image. And it kind of worries me whether this film can really neutralize the already bad image in people's mind. So do you think whether any of you are coming from that kind of country, so do you think there is a social responsibility of keeping it good? Yeah.
I don't think of it as a good or bad. Like, I just feel like we should just be telling stories, right? If we focus on just that, right? Just the personal story of each individual. For me, I'm not concerned about, with Reluctantly Queer, It's just Kwame. For me, I just think it's Kwame, it's my friend, it's his personal experience, and a lot of people can relate to it. It's not, I'm not focusing on his, on the same sex desire and him being, you know, considered queer or gay. And to my, it just surprises me how so many people are open to receiving his narrative. And even in Ghana, where it's considered a taboo. So, I don't know.
But the idea of social responsibility, I mean, that does go back, that really resonates for me during the AIDS crisis when, you know, there was a lot of, you know, a lot of feeling that gay, you know, gay men had brought this plague down about, on themselves because of their behavior. There was so little resources and money being allocated to try and find out, you know, how to cure a disease that was instantly deadly. I mean, it was a very difficult time, and there were a lot of people who said, "We have to change the way. The only way we're going to be able to get a cure is to change the way people think about gay people." And I'm not saying this is where I stood. I'm saying that this was. It sounds like that's sort of what you're experiencing to some degree in China as well. And it's a difficult question.
But then it's like the difference between like how maybe AIDS was portrayed in Philadelphia, for example.
Exactly.
And how it was portrayed in like Parting Glances or something. So like Parting Glances or Longtime Companion, they didn't shy away from like the real gay world, the sex that was going on.
Right, but Parting Glances and Longtime Companion, and I worked on Parting Glances, and I'm in Parting Glances, yeah. Actually. I mean, a lot of people felt like they were only portraying, you know,
gay white
upper middle class men, you know, and that there was a whole huge group of people being completely left out who were suffering just as badly, if not worse.
Yeah, that's true. But my point is that in Philadelphia, they don't even, I mean, deal with the idea of gay male, like the way gay men were having sex that everyone, that it was a very libertine kind of, you know, sexual movement.
Yeah, everybody was a saint.
Yeah. Especially, he only did one blowjob in a theater and got, you know, full blown AIDS or whatever. But, so I mean, I think part of it is whether art should be prescriptive or descriptive, as they used to say. Is it prescribing like some kind of the way we want you to see homosexuals or lesbians or transsexuals, or is it just describing the way society in general kind of perceives homosexuals or lesbians or transsexuals? So, I mean, there was a lot of really bad gay films made in the early years of the gay and lesbian film circuit, because people were just making these, I used to call them like cheerleading films, where it was like, yeah, we're all gay and we're all great and everything's perfect and we're not as bad as you think we are and blah, blah, blah. You know, that doesn't make for good drama or good cinema usually.
I think though it relates to this, just like, you really like the microphone. Okay. But like, comes back to this discrepancy that happened a few moments ago that I'm sort of interested in, is like, the dynamic between like who are you actually seeking to serve in some way? Because like when you're putting an image on screen, like is this purely for the sake of entertainment, or am I facilitating something for a larger, like not to whatever, but I saw Boys Don't Cry as like a 16-year-old trans person and I was like, fuck, this is my life, this is what I have coming to me, you know? And like I think these films, in a bad way, like, oh, I'm bound to like fall in love and fucking be murdered, awesome. And like, now I...
That's like every Law and Order episode. You know what I mean? It's like there's a variety of stories.
Totally. And it goes back to like...
Boys Don't Cry was also the first time they identified with a trans character.
Sure. And I think it goes back to this idea of just like, as a filmmaker, remembering what you're seeking to do. And like, if you are seeking to like create images that can like be positive in a not cheerleader way, and like that's, there's something valid to that. And if you are seeking to create images that can involve more storytelling and more entertainment and encompass, you know, bring people in that, from that direction, I think those are both perfectly valid directions. The only thing is to just think about like positionality, like where you're being positioned.
I don't really think it has, for me, it doesn't have to do with entertainment. It because obviously there's a lot of subversive cinema in the mainstream that is either unconsciously subversive or and has a subtext, or even like a lot of classical Hollywood film has homosexual subtext, and that can be very radical, but it wasn't necessarily intentional. So, you know, there's entertainment can also be very, you know, political or charged with kind of queer issues, you know, almost in spite of itself. You know, I think the problem is when you start, especially in a mainstream context, when you have the attempt to really police what how people are trying to represent queers, gays, lesbians, transsexuals, like, and to, you know, I've always had a bit of problem with this idea of, you know, prior censorship and not being able to express, you know, what you want to say because there's pressure for you to conform to a certain style of representation. So I've been given a lot of grief over the years for bad representation of you know, and but I, you know, I did it in a more sort of underground context, so I didn't have the same pressures, you know, but I think it can be very dangerous for the artist to have to conform to that kind of prior censorship.
It's part of the dynamic too of like making queerness larger rather than smaller.
I find it. Okay, sure.
Love it.
Tangerine. Because there's a lot of problems with that in the trans context. Mm-hmm. And yet it is a queer film because its mode of production in the way that it brings community together and you know, how it was made and the spectacle. But the trans, one of the trans women in it is still on the streets. You know, she didn't get paid. You know what I'm saying? She's still a part of it. So, you know, in the sense of what we're seeing on the screen, the spectacle of it, who made it, how it's made, I think that has a lot to do with, you know, is it cinema? Is it not cinema? I mean, I think there's a lot of things to think about, not just throwing up bodies and saying we're, you know, trans or queer or whatnot. So, you know what I mean? I mean, so it's a bigger question about representation, how things are made, who makes it, you know, who's in the film to really define it as queer. I mean, my classroom is blowing up around Tangerine. The trans women are on one side, the people of the color are the other side. So, you know, I guess it's queer cinema because that's what we want.
I also want to add, like, first of all, there's a question, someone waiting. Yeah, we see you and you have a mic already, but there's someone waiting for like 30 minutes over there. Just wanted to add to what you said, coming from China about the representation. I think we shouldn't really forget that the two films also that Christine made and that this entire idea, if we look at Swoon and Poison, this was about very much about the appropriation of negative representation, wasn't it? Because we had this time of, like, you know, when Vito Russo wrote The Celluloid Closet, just collecting all the negative representations. It was all about identity. We are always the evil lesbian who has to die, and so on and so forth. And then came the cinema, where all of a sudden the same characters from the films we hated were all of a sudden the criminal queers from Swoon, and we're like, you know, the HIV positive sort of like criminals in the living end, and we're like, you know, the gangsters. And I think this, we shouldn't, we don't want to add anything, I just don't want to forget that, you know, this idea of not positive representation, of very powerful sort of like activist negative representation, or turning it into a different kind of cinema, was very much part of these films. Would you agree, Christine?
I would, but to go back to what Cheryl says, I think that's different. That's right. I mean, because Tangerine, you know, the things that are inspiring about Tangerine is the content that's made on an iPhone. It feels like it's the movie against all odds, but then it's like a guy who took these people's story and gave them, you know, he gave them a voice, but he gets the credit and they don't. They're not compensated. So it becomes a much more complicated stew of what, you know, of what this movie, how this movie's seen into the world. It's not just the story itself, which is, right? I mean, I'm sort of paraphrasing what you're saying, but I'm also trying to, I'm thinking about it.
How do they?
Right.
Do you know how the two trans performers in the film feel about the filmmaker now?
All I know from my trans activist students are that the woman who is not getting the Oster campaign thrown behind her is still tricking it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, it's her own addiction, whatever is what we make of it, right?
Right.
But in some ways,
you can't really expect the filmmaker to like rehabilitate or, you know, to get the person off the street.
Sure, but then that never becomes what the legacy.
It's not
you know,
the narrative of the. Because there's the narrative of the movie
and then there's
the narrative of the movie coming
making,
out into the world.
And right. the film and the, right. the cinema. And right. so I think that we have to separate those things yeah. when we think about queer cinema. It's not just the person who made it. It's
well,
not
I mean,
just the content.
Slumdog Millionaire, they, you know, got a lot of controversy for taking, you know, characters off the street and then not compensating them properly and, you know, whatever. So, I mean, it happens in all cinema.
But we're now like flagging it as a birth of trans cinema. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So it's just, I mean, and I guess we have to like let it go and let it blow. And
for me, the filmmaker had to have my impression is that he had to have a pretty strong connection and sensitivity to those two trans women to get those kinds of performance. From them.
Slightly.
And, you know,
I mean, yeah,
well,
I'm sure. I mean, I you know, when you put a camera on a community nowadays, especially an iPhone, we know what selfies look like, right? So, you know what I'm saying? It's just like another spectacle. It's about technology, too. You know what I'm saying? It's also about technology. And who's behind the camera saying, I want to take a picture of you? Mm-hmm. Okay, if it's a white person behind the camera saying, I want to take a picture of you, it's one thing. If it's a queer person behind the camera, it's another. You know what I'm saying? It's,
I mean, that,
it's
and
a
that
different
same argument was applied to blue as the warmest color, too.
Exactly. On the other flip side.
Just want to mention that the woman asking the question is the director of The Watermelon Woman. Maybe we can give her a round of applause as well.
I just want to say something about, because we've been showing, really what's been talked about as the breakout star of Kiki is Gia. She's a trans woman. And when we bring her out, when she's been coming and speaking to audiences, she kind of gets this surprise. They're like, you're so smart. You're so articulate. That's so offensive.
Right?
It's incredibly offensive. But of course, when Twiggy and I was writing the film, we knew, you know, she just has to be in it because, you know, and she also knows that she's representing, she's trying to change the trans narrative. And this is, you know, in the team, this is a documentary film, so it's different, but that has been part of the conversation.
There has been a gentleman waiting over there for an hour, please.
Not that much. Regarding like queer cinema and temporality, I was wondering that all the independent films who became a little bit like a success in the past years, like from Brokeback Mountain to Carol, are all period movies. Like they have this, they're quite, I don't know what it is, it's like maybe enjoying the horrors of the past or the like a revisionist perspective. And all these films you have now with this this new wave queer cinema, and they're very like, yeah, they're dealing with the present things. But I was wondering, what about the future? Like, if we're, why is nobody is doing like the effort of making a queer science fiction movie? Because we can, why can't we like depict like a gender futuristic perspective or something? I only know of like Born in Flames was one, but it was like the only one.
It's not my particular
cup of tea. But there's, you know, I know lots of my students love genre, and they love gay and lesbian genre, you know, horror and sci-fi. And they have a, they find a lot of it.
Yeah, I just want to say,
there's Sense8. I mean, this is the Wachowski thing. Right.
There's loads of it, and I want to say Julie Chang just shot her new movie in Berlin called Fluido, and she made IKU 10 years ago, and I think Fluido now is like, you should all see it. Yeah.
Hello. Okay. Here, I want to land a little bit discussion. I have an impression that you will maybe confirm or not, that right now is a lot of people that making LGBTQ movies just because it's much more easy for financing, because there is a lot of communities that do that. There is a foundation that also that, and in some countries those movies have priority. I can't, do not wish to name countries, but I know them, that such movies have priority, because you all time can mask them as a fighting for the rights of the minorities, and immediately, near automatically, you have the money.
Give me the name of that country.
Yeah.
Christine. I know this country from my experience, not only one country, but it's not for publicly saying.
Does anyone want to respond to that or not? There's a general consensus that it's not easier to produce LGBTI. What I sense from you is that there is like maybe what was talked about in Israel, that there is maybe some kind of like funding that, you know, what I talked about, the use of queer, that, you know, it's kind of like chic and progressive and pink washing to do that. But if you're so vague, we have nothing to talk about, I'm afraid, right? I don't know. You can say something.
Well, I'm a Swedish producer, of Kiki. Sweden has new guidelines, so we want to give 50% to female, 50% to men, but that's where it ends. But with that comes different stories as well, like, you know, minority questions and everything. And I think... for example, in Berlinale, it's 60% female directors from Sweden, which is not normal. So we actually have been benefiting from these new guidelines.
And at the same time, 8% of female directors in the competition.
Yes.
I saw here some movies. I also know some directors that obtain money for that. I know some movies, and I think that somebody really, really do
this thematic. Is it a conspiracy? Is that what you're saying?
Not because like the thematic, or not because want to say something, but just because it's more easy to obtain the funds for such movies.
Christine Vachon has written two books about this. It's a good read for you maybe after this, about at least in the US how easy it is to get money for very uncomfortable queer films.
It's so far outside my realm of experience, I don't really know how to answer that.
But you're coming from US, if I understand well.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, maybe in US, yes, but come to Europe and see what's happening.
Jan Kühnemund of Salzgeber, former Salzgeber. No, I think that it's like, it's sort of like a consensus that you might be wrong, that no one really wants to talk about this anymore. Okay. Well, Next question.
Can I just add one thing?
Where are you?
I'm here. I'm the Swedish producer. I mean, you need to understand also, it's really difficult to make movies. You don't walk into the Swedish Film Institute and say, hey, I want to get, you know, make a queer film, give me the money. You know, you need to be smart and you need to know what you're doing in order to get the money.
Either you get specific or you, like, really, if you're vague and, like, conspiracy, then it doesn't really make sense, and I think no one wants to talk about that. At least
the idea is that two films with let's say, two near equal artistically film.
That is not LGBT what being specific means.
Have a one plus of thematic. So I see that.
Maybe you should start making queer movies. You'll get more money that way.
Is there? We're almost running out of time, but I don't want that to be the last question. So does anyone else have another question? Come on, people. We still have one filmmaker who hasn't shown his clip yet, and that is Bruce, and I think we could kind of do that, and then have the clip number, the one with the women. It's from Otto or Up With Dead People that also premiered at the Panorama, and it's clip number 4, maybe, yeah. If you really want to feel good tonight, you can come to the Kino International. The Teddy has a Jubilee series, and Christine Vachon is going to present the film Hedwig and the Angry Inch, Teddy winner, and also a feel-good carte blanche film that she chose. She's going to be awarded tomorrow with an honorary Teddy. The Teddies are tomorrow. I want to thank Christine Vachon. I want to thank Bruce LaBruce. I want to thank Sora Judenor. I want to thank Hansel Klaus. And I want to thank Adoma Owusu for being here, you for your questions, for your participation. And yeah, have a good rest of the Berlinale. Thank you.